A young thief gets more than she bargained for when she steals a key and sets in motion a power struggle between rival merchant houses to control a legendary magical technology. In Foundryside, that's the book I'm reviewing on this episode of SFF180. Hello everyone, Thomas here, your host again as always. Thank you so much for joining me. Robert Jackson Bennett is a writer who enjoys using fantasy as a means of examining power structures and, as in real life, the way power is hoarded by a small elite who feel no compunction over using it to inflict injustice upon the masses. Foundryside is an adventure that follows a familiar template in which a disparate group of people among the oppressed form an unlikely alliance to take the fight to their oppressors, and it delivers wildly entertaining results with a story full of suspense, humor, nonstop action, smartly fleshed out characters, and what may be the most science fictional approach to a magic system I've yet seen. In the city of Tavan, magic is performed through a method called scrying, in which objects are imbued with sigils that essentially rewrite the reality of that object. So, for instance, a simple weapon can be made terrifyingly lethal, or a piece of clothing can be convinced it's impregnable armor. We're meant to think of it as very much like programming code, and while this isn't the first novel to think of its magic system that way, Bennett has thought it through much more thoroughly than I've seen before. Talented scriveners have come up with new and more efficient forms of scribing language. It's an industrialized form of magic that requires a lot of trial and error before coming up with something that works, and typically, nothing works unless it is extremely precise. This is probably the story's greatest strength. In most fantasy novels, sure, there are magic systems, but they usually stop at explaining how spells are cast, and not what a spell actually has to do to work. Bennett's entire story hinges on the profound and potentially devastating consequences of being in possession of a means by which physical reality, which works by a very specific set of known laws, can simply be changed to suit someone's will. Magic in fantasy is often a means by which the nature of something's very existence is made to defy that nature. And Bennett is really keen to take that concept seriously and follow it through in his world building. Scrying is an ancient technology rediscovered and revived by the four powerful merchant houses who run Tavan. Each merchant house operates within its own vast walled-off complex, so huge that they are practically cities unto themselves, with their own laws. Think of something like the Forbidden City in Beijing, except four of them. Meanwhile, everyone else lives nestled among the outer walls of these huge estates in the Commons, a slum of dark and grimy warrens, alleys and sewers utterly lawless and dangerous to the unwary. Sanchia Grotto is a young woman and former slave earning her living as a thief in the Commons. She has a talent she doesn't quite understand. She can touch any object, even the ground, and know most everything about it. So she can touch a flight of steps and know how many people have climbed it in a day, or touch a stone wall and find where the easiest handholds are for climbing. And if she touches a scribed item, she can hear the scribing language in her head, reciting its commands, although she doesn't understand how to do anything about them. Until her latest job has her stealing a scribed key with a sentient mind and personality, calling itself Clef, which is a cute little musical pun. If scrying is like programming code, then Clef seems to be an all-purpose hacking tool, able to open any door, and even affect other scribed objects in ways that persuade them to defy their coded instructions. As Sanchi and Clef begin to bond as actual companions and friends, we learn more about Clef's possible origin, tied into long-standing rumors and myths about the Occidental Empire, an ancient extinct civilization that invented scrying. Its most powerful scriveners were said to be able to rewrite nature and life itself, even to the point of creating their own gods. Much of this is dismissed as wild myth, but the stories haven't stopped the merchant houses from ransacking every remnant of Occidental civilization that they can find in the hopes of discovering those all-powerful sigils. Now, could Clef be a long-lost item from those ancient days? Could the people who hired Sanchia be preparing the most dangerous power play in Tavan's history? Bennett hits the ground running with his story and very rarely lets up through the course of its 500 pages. Among the themes the book tackles are the sociopathy of inherited wealth, and the way in which an unregulated hypercapitalist system essentially pursues its own form of world domination, not with armies and siege engines, but through absolute control of the economic and practical survival of entire nations. Sanchia, whose past is darker than anyone deserves, is an admirable heroine. Thieves in fantasy fiction are a dime a dozen, yeah. But it is Sanchia's stoicism and sense of self-determination amidst traumatizing levels of adversity that makes her memorable and likable. But in addition to Clef, it's her unlikely team of allies that make the story. Gregor Dandolo is a captain of the guard and the heir of the Dandolo merchant house, but he's shunned the life he could have led in the wake of some horrendous military experiences, and now has this strangely noble idea of bringing law and order and justice to the commons. But will his family name ever allow him that degree of independent action? Ample humor is supplied by Orso Ignacio, an official with the Dandolo house, with an agenda his employer might not be pleased to discover. I desperately want to see Steve Buscemi play this guy. Orso's assistant, the scrivener Berenice, is the real brains of the outfit, and she also becomes a love interest for Sanchia that helps the young thief experience something like real human compassion for the very first time. And with the added help of Claudia and Giovanni, a couple of underground scriveners working illegally in the commons, the team gets up to some very enjoyable Ocean's 11 shenanigans, as the story ultimately requires Sanchia to break into the largest and most protected stronghold in the entire city. Yeah, some moments in the book are a bit too talky, but mostly I had a whale of a time reading this. Foundryside is just high-energy storytelling, cinematic in its sweep and full of likable rogues, bloody fight scenes and stylishly hissable villains, with a plot that keeps raising the stakes and the sense of spectacle, leaving us eager for more. And that is all I have time for in this episode of SFF 180. Remember, guys, the most important thing, these are reviews. You will not always agree with me, but if you enjoyed watching, please hit that like button, share the video far and wide with all of your SFF reading friends, and above all, please subscribe if you have not done so. That is how the channel grows. You can also support the channel at my TeePublic store and at my Patreon, where recruits in DeWink's army get little perks like getting to see these videos early, things like that. I want to thank all of those people for their additional $2 a month support. I want to thank you guys for being the best viewers in all of BookTube, and until I see you all next time, happy reading.